Good evening. Welcome to North American Martyrs Parish. Our entrance hymn is in the songbook, number 314. All are welcome, number 314.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. I'm happily joined by Deacon Ralph Poyo, who comes to us to give us a mission as a parish to renew our devotion to the Lord and our dedication to be disciples and follow in his path. And so I look forward to hearing the message you bring us, and for all of us as well, to rededicate ourselves to the Lord in this word and in these sacred mysteries. And so let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare our hearts to receive him this day.
You call us into relationship with the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
By your death and resurrection, you free us from the bonds of sin. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
By the sending and indwelling of your Spirit, you bring us to the heart of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
We praise you, we bless you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that always pondering spiritual things, we may carry out in both word and deed that which is pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. In those days, Saul went down to the desert of Ziph with 3,000 picked men of Israel to search for David in the desert of Ziph. So David and Abishai went among Saul's soldiers by night and found Saul lying asleep within the barricade with his spear thrust into the ground at his head, and Abner and his men sleeping around him. Abishai whispered to David, "God has delivered your enemy into your grasp this day. Let me nail him to the ground with one thrust of the spear. I will not need a second thrust." But David said to Abishai, "Do not harm him, for who can lay hands on the Lord's anointed and remain unpunished?" So David took the spear and the water jug from their place at Saul's head, and they got away without anyone seeing or knowing or awakening. All remained asleep because the Lord had put them into a deep slumber. Going across to an opposite slope, David stood on the remote hilltop at a great distance from Abner, son of Ner, and the troops. He said, "Here is the king's spear. Let an attendant come over to get it. The Lord will reward each man for his justice and faithfulness. Today, though the Lord delivered you into my grasp, I would not harm the Lord's anointed." The word of the Lord.
According to our crimes. The Lord is kind and merciful. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he put our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. The Lord is kind and merciful.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being, the last Adam, a life-giving spirit. But the spiritual was not first, rather the natural and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, earthly. The second man from heaven. As was the earthly one, so also are the earthly. And as the heavenly one, so also are the heavenly. Just as we have borne the image of the earthly one, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly one. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, to you who hear, I say, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. To the person who strikes you on one cheek, offer the other one as well. And from the person who takes your cloak, do not withhold even your tunic. Give to everyone who asks of you, and from one who takes what is yours, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. For if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do the same. If you lend money to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners and get back the same amount. But rather, love your enemies and do good to them and lend expecting nothing back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, for he himself is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Stop judging, and you will not be judged. Stop condemning, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and gifts will be given to you. A good measure, packed together, shaken down, and overflowing, will be poured into your lap. For the measure with which you measure will in return be measured out to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, good morning. Just checking. It's an interesting gospel, isn't it? Particularly in this day and age. But before we get to that, I don't know about you, but when I was younger, I was sitting in the pew, and someone like me, a missionary or another priest or deacon was coming up and he said, hey, I'm here to do a mission and I'd like you to give up 3 extra nights. And honestly, I'd be sitting there going, really? Why do I need to give up 3 extra nights? I mean, I'm here for church. What else does God want? Blood? So typically, no, I wouldn't make time. I had other things to do and I frankly didn't want to come. So I never made time for the missions or anything extra. I just came to Mass. That's all I need to do, so that's all I was going to do. Well, my prayer for you and I today, during the time of this homily, is maybe we can answer the question, well, why might I want to go back and clear my schedule for the mission? Along with maybe unpacking a little bit of the reading, because the reading today kind of lends itself to where we're going to go in the mission. See, Jesus comes to the crowd and he says, those of you who hear, listen. And then he begins to unpack his teaching. But frankly, if Jesus were to come here and speak to our world that we live in today and give these words, what kind of reaction do you think people out in the world would give him? Okay, I know you're just used to staring at the guy who's speaking, but you're creeping me out. You need to respond. And some of you are even wearing masks, so that's even scarier, okay? So tell me, how do you think? If Jesus comes and says, love your enemies, are you kidding me? In this culture, we're being trained to make enemies. He says, don't judge, but now we're judging everybody. Now we're being trained to judge everybody by the way you look. Isn't that true? What's your color? What's your ethnic background? We're being judged whether we wear a mask or not. We're being judged whether we're getting vaccinated or not. We're being taught to judge. And here's Jesus coming to us and going, don't judge. However you judge, you're going to be judged. So in a lot of ways, what's going on is Jesus is coming and introducing, and maybe for our culture today, such a radical thought, because nobody lives like that. And the problem is that we don't live like that because we really don't know God. And the farther away we get from God, the farther away we get from understanding who we are because we're created in his image. So if we don't know God, how do we expect to receive the mercy that the readings are really all about today, right? David showed mercy on Saul. He didn't kill him and he had a chance. Even though God had everyone fall asleep, he gave mercy. And Jesus comes and says, give mercy. But how can we do that if we don't even want mercy? Because you see, mercy isn't just given. Mercy has to be asked for it by the person who acknowledges that they're guilty and really deserve the punishment. But do we do that? Come on. It's such a foreign word. Please tell me I'm not the only one when I'm hearing this going like, there's no way in the world in this world. Jesus would probably be run out of town if he came in and started doing that. You think? If he just started teaching and they hadn't seen any miracles, didn't know who he was from Adam, he'd probably get tossed on his ear immediately. Like, what kind of garbage is this? We don't live this way. If somebody hits you on the cheek, turn the other cheek. Give me a break. Somebody hits you on the cheek, you're going to turn around and punch him back. That's the culture we live in today. We're so far away from that. And that just leads us to the next question. What happens if we really don't know? Because God is trying to come and show us the way to salvation. But what happens if we really don't know the way? That would be a huge obstacle, right? Let me give you an example. Many years ago, I was living in South Florida, making millions of dollars as a youth minister in the Catholic Church. You're still awake, that's good. And I was responsible for preparing my high school students for the sacrament of confirmation. You know what that is, right? Okay, nod yes or no would be great. Okay, good. Yes? That's the sacrament that once you get your certificate, you never have to learn about God ever again, right? What do you mean no? Of course that's true. Because most of us stopped going to any religious education after we got confirmed. Isn't that true? That's what we're really teaching our kids. As a youth minister, kids would come, Deacon, why do I have to go to classes? Why do I have to keep learning about God? My parents don't. How do I answer that? I don't know, ask them, I guess. I had no answer, right? But they were always asking me tough questions, you know, because we hung out. We spent a lot of time with them. I invested time in my teenagers. And so they would come to me and go, come on, Dad, why do we have to go to church? Right? Ever heard that? Ever said that? Don't lie, you're in church, bro. You know where you go if you lie. That's right. Washington, D.C. Don't do it. All right? So yeah, why do I have to go to church? Or my kids would go, why do I have to get confirmed? I don't understand what confirmation is. Why do I have to get confirmed? And I said, okay, fine. I'll answer your questions by way of asking you a couple of questions first. So imagine a space. I've got maybe 50, 60 kids in a room, and I got a dry erase board in the front, and I get a black marker, and in big bold letters, I write a question at the top of the board. And I said, before we get to this question at the top of the board, I want to ask you a question here in the room, and I'm going to ask you guys here tonight at Mass the same question. And I told my kids, if this question pertains to you, I would like you to raise your hand. If it doesn't pertain to you, don't raise your hand, okay? They all nodded yes, and I said, okay, how many of you want to go to heaven? I see some hands not raised, really wondering why you're here today. Okay, good. Good. That's important. Because if his hand wasn't raised, you would be in real trouble, okay? So that's good. So all my kids raised their hands, and I said, terrific. Well, if you all want to go to heaven, then obviously you know the answer to the question on the board. They all look up, and in big, bold letters, it says, how do you get to heaven? And they look up like, and then they look at me like deer in headlights, like, but you guys here, I'm sure you know the answer because you, most of you have been old enough to go on a road trip, yes or no? And in the old days, you used to use this thing called a map before GPS. And of course, you'd sit down and you'd chart out the course, figure out if it's a couple of day drive, where you're going to stay overnight, how many tanks of gas. But the one thing you'd make sure is you knew how to get there, yes or no? Excellent. So surely you know the answer because you all raised your hands and you've been on road trips. So by now, surely you know the answer. How do you get to heaven? And so my kids looked at me and I'm like, well, did you know that God has a very specific plan to get us to heaven? It doesn't just happen. It's a specific plan. And they said, no, I didn't know that. Well, did you know Satan, the devil, who is, by the way, quite real and alive and well. Boy, you look at our world today, it looks like his plan seems to be working pretty good, you think? Did you know that in the United States, 80% of baptized Catholics have left the church? 80%. So I told my kids, if God has a plan to get us to heaven and Satan has a plan to keep us from going to heaven, don't you think you ought to know the plan? And they said, well, yeah. So I started poking them. Come on. Give me something. How do you get to heaven? What do you need to do to get to heaven? And they're like, how do we get this guy to shut? I mean, be quiet. So finally, one kid does what he does in school. He's going to throw out something and hope it sticks. Oh, yes, I'm going to pray. Nice. I grab my marker, bullet point, daily prayer. Another kid catches on. Oh, I'm going to go to Mass. Good one. Bullet point, weekly Mass attendance. Another kid catches on. I'm going to go to reconciliation once a year, whether I need it or not. Nice. Yearly reconciliation. And then finally, the other kid threw out an answer that I think most of us in a room would agree that this is probably the answer. When you take all the homilies we've heard and the religious education we've received, and you synthesize it down into a simple phrase, most of us would probably agree this is probably it. And he raises his hand and goes, I'm gonna be good. I'm like, whoa. Bullet point, achieve perfection. How are we doing at that? Anybody here achieving perfection, living a perfect life? Anyone? How about you guys up there in the choir loft? You're closer to God than we are. I just need a yes or a no. Crickets. Well, if you can't do it and we can't do it, surely the altar servers, dudes, you guys, I mean, you look holy. And are you guys living a perfect life? And remember, your parents are here. Yes or no? No? Man, Brothers? No? We only have one more hope. Oh. You see, this is our problem, isn't it? It's the human condition. It's just so easy to sin, isn't it? I mean, you could leave church today and sin in the parking lot when you leave, couldn't you? Someone cuts you off on the way out, and you'd be tempted to send them off with a little blessing, wouldn't you? Or we would go home tonight and turn on the TV and watch something absolutely horrific on television that you and I both know Jesus would never be sitting on the sofa next to us in heaven watching. But we still watch it, don't we? No matter what Hollywood says, whether it's rated for adults or not, Jesus wouldn't even be watching some of the PG stuff. But we keep doing it. So I told my kids, you know what we got to do? We got to join the church, which requires also that you get your sacrament of baptism and confirmation. We know we got to go to Mass on the weekend, because if we don't go to Mass on the weekend and we die in a state of mortal, well, we go to Mass on a weekend without a good and valid excuse, we commit a mortal sin. And if we die in a state of mortal, we go to. So we know that. And then we got to leave these doors, get into that parking lot, and go out into this incredibly sinful world and do the very best we can, right? Hoping at the end of our lives it's good enough to get us in. Yes? Let me see. Yes? Raise your hands. Yes? Excellent. Only the problem is that's absolutely wrong. That's actually a form of a heresy, where people think that the way they get to heaven is by doing good works. Like, you know, you're trying to outweigh the bad things you do by doing good things. But what did Jesus say? He said, I am the light of the world, and in me there is no darkness at all. None at all. So my brothers and sisters, now that we understand that we really don't know the saving plan of God, we really don't know how to get to heaven, my question to you is do you want to know? Yes? Excellent. All right, buckle up. We can do this in an hour and a half. I'm serious. But I'm not going to do it here, because you didn't come to Mass expecting to be here for 2.5-hour Mass. But this is why I've come. That's why Father invited me to come, because I'm going across the country. I'm a full-time missionary, and I'm seeing churches full of people who have the same perception that somehow all we got to do is go to church, be a good person, and that's what gets you into heaven. And they're totally misunderstood. Do you understand that good people can go to hell? We don't even understand what that looks like. We don't even understand what is taking place. And I suspect the reason we don't is because you're very much like me. You see, I'm the poster child for the kid that went through my confirmation and I left the church. I left. Why? Because this doesn't mean anything to me. I'd come to Mass and do the same things you guys do. I'd sit in the pew and Father's getting ready to do stuff and the church is doing stuff and we would do our, you know, spiritual exercises. Kneel, sit, stand, kneel, sit, stand, kneel, sit, stand. But for me, there was this huge disconnect. It's almost as if there's this plate glass window that separates what Father and the altar servers are going to do up there, because a miracle is going to happen in 10 minutes. Do you even see the miracle? Do you even believe in the miracle? Because surveys across the country say that only 27% of people in the pews believe in the true presence of Jesus. So if the church is doing something, and the way it's supposed to work is that the anointing and the blessing all comes from here and flows off and goes out here, because out here, particularly if you still have little ones, there's an incredible amount of life taking place out here. There's all kinds of stuff that's going on. Couples were fighting on their way into church tonight. And you show up here and you put your nice smiley face on, you get back in the car and you're going to fight on the way home. People are hurting out here. People are suffering out here. And I don't know about you, but the one thing I could never understand is, what does that have to do with what's going on out here? Please tell me I'm not the only one with that disconnect. Because I want to know what this has to do with the pain and suffering of our lives. Is it relevant? Does it mean anything? Or do we just have to come here every week and have a mediocre experience of our faith? Is this all there is to Catholicism? Is to sit in the pew and put up with an hour of wah-wah, wah-wah, wah-wah? Or could it possibly be that maybe we're missing something? Or more accurately, maybe we're missing someone. Because my senior year of high school, after I left the church, someone took the time and made the effort to show me how to find Jesus. I didn't even know you could. But the day that I found Jesus, everything changed. Everything. And why would it not? Because when we're created in the image of God, it means we're made for love, because the scriptures say that God is love. We're made for love. So how could you not be experience a profound transformation when you encounter the person who is the source of all the love we experience in the world? It all comes from him, flows through our spouses, flows through our parents, flows through our children. It's all coming from him. And the more I grew closer to Jesus, the more love I was experiencing. It was, and ask anyone in the pews who has found him like I have. Once you have found Jesus, you know what you want? More. So you do your own test right now, whether or not you found him. You can tell right now. In your heart, can you experience any love from God? In your heart, do you experience any love for God? Or is he just this guy we've heard about up there, and he's up there and we're down here and there's just like nothing? Because we've never really met. If you don't have that experience, then I'm here to tell you, you're missing the absolute best part of being Catholic. You're missing God. Wouldn't you like to come to Mass and actually have a profound experience of Mass? Wouldn't you like to come to Mass because you really want to, not because you have to, because you're using it as fire insurance? You know what I'm talking about. When is the last time you came to Mass and you were really looking for Jesus? You see what I mean? It's so easy to just get distracted and pulled away and no focus on God at all. And then we just get into this ritual rut where we're doing the same thing over and over and over again, and it means absolutely nothing. That's why I left. But I came back with a vengeance when I found him. And then started connecting the dots of what actually takes place here and why. And then I started to understand how. So Sunday night, here, 7 o'clock, we're going to explain the saving plan of God. Because you know what? These beautiful little souls, they're looking to us to show them the way. But I'm going to give you a profound truth right now so to make sure you can leave with something tonight. If we are not leading our kids to God by the way we live our lives, we are leading them away from God. Mom, Dad, Grandpa, Grandma, I want to get to heaven. How do you get there? Is your answer, I don't know? Then you might want to come tomorrow night. Second night, we're going to talk about spiritual warfare. I'm going to show you some of the plans of Satan. I'm going to show you how he's actually trained every one of us in this room to reject Jesus Christ every day, and I will prove it to you. Third night, we're going to talk about the best-kept secret of the Catholic Church, the Holy Spirit. He's been given to us, but when's the last time you had any serious catechesis on what to do with the Holy Spirit? He's more than just a dove. He's here for us. And in fact, the secret is we can't get to heaven without him. So I hope you'll think about this time. It's a 3-night investment in preparation. 3 nights of giving up whatever you had planned to watch on TV. 3 nights. But it'll be the best investment you make in your life. not because of me, not because of anything that I say, but because of what God will show you if you choose to come. If you do choose to come, I just encourage you, make sure you get here early, because, boy, I can promise you, those back pews, they're going to fill up quick.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in the Holy Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, teach us how to pray.
We pray for the families of our church, particularly those with young children and the difficult challenges they experience every day in the raising of children. Lord, we ask for the grace to be filled upon them that they might experience your divine presence in their home, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Particularly, we lift up those families who have special needs children, who suffer silently and carry a heroic cross, that they may come to know the love of God in a profound way, and that we might support them in their way, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For marriages that are struggling this very day, that they might be strengthened and that they might set at the foot of your cross the burdens that they carry and the lies that they are fighting, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the elderly who are struggling and who are lonely, for those who are suffering with the real pandemic of loneliness, that they might once again be restored to their family, individual families, but as well as the parish family, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our military and first responders and for their safety, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are struggling with short-term and long-term illnesses, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For wisdom for our governments, local and national, that they would look for the good of all their people, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And lastly, for those who have passed away this night or have passed away this week, that they might be welcomed into your eternal home, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. We offer this Mass for the health and intention of Connor Molly, for all those intentions that we hold now in the silence of our hearts and bring to the Father. We pray to the Lord. God our Father, hear these, our humble petitions, and answer them as they are in accord with thy will. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Our offertory hymn is number 492 in the songbook, Where Charity and Love Prevail, number 492.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all the Church.
As we celebrate your mysteries, O Lord, with the observance that is your due, we humbly ask you that what we offer to the honor of your majesty may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation. Through Christ our Lord, through him the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with the North American martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and James, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And with your
spirit. Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Our communion hymn is number 435 in the songbook, Be Not Afraid, number 435.
Come follow me.
prayer to Our Lady of Guadalupe, and thanksgiving for protection in time of pandemic. Holy Virgin of Guadalupe, Queen of the Angels and Mother of the Americas, we fly to you today as your beloved children. We ask you to intercede for us with your Son, as you did at the wedding in Cana. Pray for us, loving Mother, and gain for our nation and world, and for all our families and loved ones, the protection of your holy angels, that we may be spared the worst of this illness. For those already afflicted, we ask you to obtain the grace of healing and deliverance. Hear the cries of those who are vulnerable and fearful. Wipe away their tears and help them to trust. In this time of trial and testing, teach all of us in the church to love one another and to be patient and kind. Help us to bring the peace of Jesus to our land and to our hearts. We come to you with confidence, knowing that you truly are our compassionate mother, health of the sick and cause of our joy. Shelter us under the mantle of your protection. Keep us in the embrace of your arms, and help us always to know the love of your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let us pray. And we pray, Almighty God, that we may experience the effects of the salvation which is pledged to us by these mysteries, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The petition to rescind or demand a public vote on the recent Lincoln City Ordinance redefining gender norms in the municipal code is available to sign in the back after Mass. Please ask the petition's representatives for more details.
Once again, thank you, Deacon Ralph, for being here with us. I already learned a thing or two. I'm not making enough use of the space here, so I think I'll talk to Father Connor and we'll be coming out more often. So get ready, there's no safe place, but in all seriousness, I think there is a new perspective you can give us. And bringing us closer and enlightening us with the Holy Spirit, giving us a renewed sense of our mission. So I look forward to the nights, 7 o'clock, to be with you.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace. Saint Michael,
the archangel, defend us in battle.
Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the root souls.
Our closing hymn is number 484 in the songbook, Love Has Come, number 484.
Prophets here.
Please join in our thanksgiving prayer. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine.